Hey, what's up, everybody, and welcome to Rock Video Rental. I am Brandon, and with me, as always, is Caleb. And today, we're going to be talking about 1917 and continuing on with our war movie month. But before we get to that, we'll do like we always do. And Caleb, have you been watching anything good?
Nothing really new. You know, Bob's Burgers. The only other thing that I realized I have been watching for the past couple of weeks, and it's just very like sporadic, is that my wife is watching Blue Bloods.
Okay.
So I've conned some of those episodes. So really decent show. I mean, you know, Tom Selleck is usually always pretty solid, and
Yeah. They've
got some interesting, you know, I mean, cop shows are cop shows. So a lot of them kind of regurgitate some of the same stuff, but they've got a good cast and, you know, pretty good content. So that's pretty fun to watch. Really outside of that though, nothing else to share. What about you?
I don't have a whole heck of a lot. I've been really super busy lately. I've seen a couple episodes of King of the Hill here and there. I don't remember if I said this last time, but I'll just say it. I watched the last episode of Who Killed WCW.
Okay.
I'm like, that was pretty good. But it seemed like a lot of the interviewers they had on there were just like passing a blame game.
Yeah.
When in reality, like, there's millions of things that went into killing WCW and why it failed. But it was still kind of interesting. And after watching that, I've gone back on Peacock, I guess it is now, but all the WWE stuff's on there. I've been watching WCW Monday Nitro.
Nice.
I started with like the first one, and I've fallen asleep through a couple of them, but I have to go back and see what I missed. But man, that's pretty much it. I've been watching this guy on YouTube. He does wrestling content. His channel, I think it's like Marky D123 or something like that.
Marky Mark.
But he has this he's like a British guy. And he's got this series that he does called Ring of the Hawk, where like he'll take a wrestler who had like a short run in some federation, and then like he covers their matches and gives them each a grade. And at the end, like he gives them like a final grade, see if like it was any good or not. And he's got like this character that he calls Hawk Hogan, which is like a hawk with Hulk Hogan's head on it.
Nice.
Yeah. And he's got like all these catchphrases and stuff in it. It's kind of interesting. So I've been kind of binging some of those.
Rock.
But yeah, that's pretty much it for me.
Well, yeah,
but
we got.
I
was going to say, we got a guest coming up for this show.
Yeah,
so.
I was going to say, I did watch 1917, and we brought our friend Jason on with us to talk about that. So we might as well just jump right into it. So 1917, it is from 2019 and is directed by Sam Mendes. The plot is, as an infantry battalion assembles to wage war deep in the enemy territory, two soldiers are assigned to race against time and deliver a message that will stop 1,600 men from walking straight into a deadly trap. The cast, we got Dean Charles Chapman as Corporal Blake, George McKay as Corporal Schofield, Daniel Mays as Sergeant Sanders, Colin Firth as Colonel Aaron Moore, Pip Carter as Lieutenant Gordon, and Andy Apollo as Sergeant Miller.
And honestly, there's basically just two actors the whole time.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
Yeah. Every once in a while, yeah. Like, he comes across a bunch of people, then, you know, then there's more
cameos here or there.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah. And a few I mean, not that this is like anything of a low budget or like off the beaten path movie, but the first time I watched, I was surprised by a few of the big name actors that make an appearance. You know, probably Cumberbatch was the one towards the end that was one of the more surprising ones.
Yeah, right, yeah. I was surprised to see him.
And then he played a total ass.
Yeah, for sure. Oh gosh. Yeah, it's the first time watch for me. I don't know about you guys.
Oh, really? No, I've
Yeah.
seen it a few times, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, it was at
No,
least
that's good. I
the
like it.
Yeah, I think it was third, but I know it was at least the second. So I have a little bit of a story about the first time watch that I had with this movie. Because I think I watched in 2019, it may have been 2020. But I was up late last night, or not last night, but the night, and I was starting in. I was like, oh, it's a 2-hour-long movie. I'll just watch the first half and then I'll watch the second half the next night. And it was already like midnight or something. But the movie was so good and I got so like engrossed with it that I just powered through and watched the whole thing until after 2 a.m.
It's gonna you just sucked in. I'm like, ah, I've already made the commitment. I'm gonna keep it, keep going.
Yeah, that's how you know
Yeah,
it's at least a good movie when you don't wanna
sure.
stop and watch it the next night.
Yeah.
I'll forget about it the next night.
So it's probably a COVID watch for you.
Yeah, very
Well,
well
you're at
could
home anyway, so you might as well just watch all of
be. Yep.
Oh.
No, I think I
Yeah, I
went
remember
and
when it came out, but I didn't see it until just now.
Yeah, I saw it in theaters, I believe, when it
Oh,
first came
nice.
out. I think
Yeah,
my
that.
brother saw it in theater too, and he was the one that told me to watch it. And
It would have been a good one to watch in theater. It was actually kind of funny. I think
Sure.
my mom and my nephew saw it in theater. And my nephew liked it, but my mom wasn't really didn't think it was all that great. So when I did watch it the first time, though, I was kind of disappointed that I didn't get a chance to watch it in theater because it's definitely one of those movies that you know it would have been a great theater experience.
Oh yeah, it's definitely an immersive. Like, I mean, the whole movie is shot like that way, right? Where it just feels better as a theater experience.
Yeah, it's a beautifully shot movie. Some of the like the long tracking shots and the pans around like the characters and stuff.
Yeah, I
Yeah,
guess that's.
it almost feels like a video game like the whole time.
Yeah. Yeah, almost like a third person shooter or something. Yeah. I can see that.
Yeah, and I guess that's kind of like a good conversation piece to start off with. And shoot, I don't have it down on exactly what the term is, but the one shot perspective.
Yeah.
Dang it, there's a specific term for it. So that's pretty unique. I mean, first of all, in movies in general, but especially for a war movie. So basically, where they made it feel like the movie was one continuous shot, except for when he got knocked out that one time. So that I when I started watching it, I didn't. Did you know that going in, Brandon? Since this was your first time watch, that was that kind of a setup, or?
Yeah, I remembered hearing about it,
Okay.
but I didn't really. I only saw like a few clips of it, like the scene of the plane coming down and they run into the barn and fall to the ground to try to dodge it. I remember seeing that. That was in a trailer, but
Yeah. What about you,
yeah.
Jason? Did you know that going in that the movie was
No, I'm trying to remember honestly, but I think so. I think I knew it was going to be almost like a third person view the whole time. Almost like you're interacting like on the same level as them the whole time. So, but I mean, it does a really good job to kind of fool you into thinking, like, even though there's quite a few different cuts, I guess,
Yeah.
they do such a good job disguising it that it's like, it just feels like one long, like how do they learn all their lines,
Oh, yeah.
makes you think that they just learned them all and like everything's just perfect, but it's nice because it's a nice like full journey through that whole adventure.
Yeah,
But yeah, I had no idea. I mean, I don't remember. I don't think I had any idea going into it.
I don't recall that I did either, and I think that's part of the reason why I like couldn't put the movie down because I was just like, oh man, this is like, I mean, war movies are war movies, but it was done in such a completely different manner where it was just kind of like a new experience altogether.
And I think even know, I mean, like, what other movie have you seen that's done that? So it's even knowing it wasn't preparing you, I feel like, for the actual experience. Because I can't recall any movie that's done that. besides this one that, you know, that I've seen at least, but.
Yeah, same here. I will say that some of like the camera shots, like the, I mean, there was one scene where it happens a couple times, but there's one that stands out to me is where he's looking across like a field, and like the camera kind of pans like around his back, and you can see like
Yeah.
all around him and stuff. It really reminded me of like old westerns, like the John Ford movies, like The
Yeah.
Searchers is one really. Because there's a scene where John Wayne walks out on like the front porch of this house, and like the camera comes out from the doorway, and it's kind of like pans around. And you see like this big vast like desert in front of him. That's what it really reminded me of.
Yeah. I just looked it up real quick, and kind of like terms that they use are one-shot films or continuous shot films.
Okay.
And I'm not, I mean, I don't, I see some of these on this list that came up that I know are not continuous shot films. I mean, I think they all contain scenes that are very long, in continuous shots, but the whole
Right.
film isn't. So I don't really know of another one that went to the lengths that this movie did for the continuous shot.
Yeah, see that
So,
Birdman is considered a continuous shot movie.
yeah, I haven't seen that
is
one
it?
yet.
Yeah,
Me
I didn't
either.
either. I still gotta get around to it.
And
My
I'm too
man,
busy
Michael
watching terrible
Keaton.
action movies and
Come on, yeah.
bad horror movies that are shot on VHS, but the complete opposite of something like this. I,
Yeah,
other than the
having.
cinematography, like this, the score for this movie like just fits so well with it.
Yeah, it won some awards too, didn't it? Just the score alone, I believe, did.
Yeah, I believe so.
Yeah.
Pretty sure at least nominated, so
Won like three awards. Yeah.
it might have
Sound
got a.
mixing.
Yeah, it might have been nominated at least for the cinematography as well.
Dude, so good. No, yeah, the music matches so well with the score
Yeah.
does.
Us coming off of just watching Saving Private Ryan, like I feel like Saving Private Ryan kind of has that more iconic soundtrack that fit really well, but then also like you can hear and you probably like can recollect pretty quickly what's from. This one, 1917, has a great soundtrack, but honestly, like, I don't know if I heard it, if I would be able to pick out exactly what it's
Sure.
from.
Yeah.
But
Yeah, it just kind of blends.
it just blended so well.
It won three Oscars, I guess, for best achievement in visual effects, best achievement in sound mixing, and best achievement in cinematography. And it was nominated for a bunch of other ones, even
The
best picture.
sound mixing makes sense then.
Yeah.
I can blend between them all. Yeah.
Yeah, the soundtrack was or the score was nominated for music.
For that.
Doesn't surprise me.
Yeah.
And also, this movie is really well acted. I mean, you're mostly with George MacKay the whole time. I thought he did a really good job. And he doesn't even really have to speak too many lines because, I mean, he's by himself most of the
Right, yeah.
time. Yeah.
Well, you can
It's
just kind of just yeah, he does it through expression, right? Like you're not trying to cause a stir half the time, and he's trying to be quiet, running, you know, either through like the cityscapes or tithing or whatever, trying to get his way there.
yeah.
It makes me kind of wonder too, like I don't know a lot of this information. I don't know if you have in facts and trivia, Brandon, but like how grueling of a movie this may have been to film. 'Cause it I kind of have to imagine between all the different stuff that they did to make it seem realistic and how many times they may have had to do it. Dude was probably exhausted most of the time anyways.
Yeah.
So like him looking disheveled and exhausted may have been able to come a little bit more naturally. But yeah,
Right.
he did really well. And it kind of makes me wonder if it was easier for him that way, not having a lot of lines, or if that kind of makes the situation more difficult, where it's just like you have to be all that more convincing with your bodily acting
Yeah.
because you're not vocalizing anything. So,
Yeah, I could see that. I think the most tense scene, at least for me, like other than, you know, the parts towards the end, but when he goes like through that one city and like he's, you know, gets injured, and then that woman in that house like helps him, like all leading up to that where he's like running through the city and like someone hears him and he attacks the guy with the and he has to stab him. And like the whole wrestling around with the knife and everything, like, and try not to make any noise so he's not, you know, noticed. Like that was pretty high in anxiety there.
You're talking about the one where kind of in the middle of it is the scene. I think it was like a burning church. Yeah, that little scene right there, just the burning church, is like super like awesomely shot and kind of like framed in the picture. So I know exactly what you're talking about.
Well, yeah, because I think it was like right before that, one of my favorite shots. So yeah, I think it was after he leaves, that like safe house room or whatever with the girl and her baby. Was like maybe it was before or after, I'm trying to remember, but like the with all the flares going off, and then like it's just like slightly lighting up the areas, and then obviously he's shot at running through, so like using that cover of darkness, but also, you know, like just getting that really dramatic and dim lighting kind of fading in and out, you know. You never know if he's going to just be shot or where, you know. So that was actually really really cool
Yeah,
how
and
that was
it's
shot.
yeah, not too long after he leaves that safe spot with the woman and her baby, that that's when he gets in that knife fight, and then it
Yeah, like
leads up to like
immediately.
him getting out of there, and then floating down the river, and then he just hits like that. There's like this branch that's across the river, and but there's like 20 bodies piled up
No,
around it, and
all
he has to
the
climb over the bodies, and he gets to shore, and he just like takes a minute, and it's like
you know
to finally breathe because of like all of the crazy stuff that was going on.
No, they really pushed, I think, his humility a lot, because it's like you know, there's many times where he's going from like this calm demeanor to, or like a situation to like super stressful, like being shot at or chased or, you know, whatever. So, but it kept like going through almost like this cycle of like back and forth between that. So you always like, even when you think like there's like this tension or like this free tension that's just gone, and just all of a sudden it just adds right back up again, and it just he's right back in the shit, right? So it was wild.
Yeah, that was around the time when the movie really started picking up, because there was times a little bit before this where I thought like the pacing was a little bit off. But I guess if you're covering such a vast part of the, you know, that he has to cover to get from where he was stationed to where he has to deliver the message, it's probably going to be a
Yeah, there's
bit
some dull
boring at
moments, right?
times. Walking up middle of nowhere where there's no one around kind of thing. One scene that kind of caught me off guard was when that plane went down. You know, crashes into the barn, and like the visuals on that were amazing. And then like, you know, they dodged that, and then they pull the pilot out, and was it Lieutenant Blake? Is that his name? He's like standing there with the guy, and then like the dude that they just pulled out of a burning plane stabs him. That's what I was like, wow, this asshole.
No, that was definitely shocking to me when I watched it the first time, because it happened so quickly, and also like it started kind of when the camera was facing the other direction. So you're just like, it was in a lot of war movies, they make it such an emphasis when somebody gets killed. Like, thinking back to Saving Private Ryan, like when anybody got killed, like, you know, the sniper got blown out with tank blowing up the building, you know, Vin Diesel got shot by a sniper, and you saw like they show it to you. So it made it all the more unique that you turn away and you follow Schofield or however you say his name, to what he was doing, and then you turn around and then Blake is getting stabbed and dying, and you're just like, what the heck
Yeah.
just happened?
How much will this change on a dime? Yeah.
And yet Blake dies relatively early in the movie. Like, I thought he was gonna last longer than that.
Yeah, I think it
Yeah,
was
it's like a
like,
third the way.
yeah, I think
Like a half
it's like,
hour into it or something.
did I put it down?
45 minutes, something like that.
40, yeah, I put it down. So it's a 2 hour long movie, and it was 45 minutes in that he died. So
Yeah.
yeah, he didn't even make it halfway through.
Yeah, the only time mark I had is like, it's been 36 minutes and not a lot has happened.
Yeah. Well,
But
that is kind of the interesting thing, because I totally get that where, especially towards the beginning, it can be very, maybe considered kind of on more on the boring side, but it was establishing quite a bit, and they interjected a couple of cool things. One of the first cool things, well, I don't know if I would say cool, but interesting things that they did was Schofield tore up his hand on the barbed wire, and then they were hiding in one of the little pits or whatever, and Blake accidentally bumped into him, and his hand went into a corpse. And just thinking about how you have an open wound, and then you just put in a dead body. That just like, ugh. Each time I watched that, it was just totally gross. But they had some pretty interesting conversations. Like, I mean, the thought totally crosses your mind on being like, Schofield was probably pissed at Blake on being like, dude, you basically volunteered me for a suicide mission that I didn't even want.
I mean, he said that, right? He's like, I thought we were just going there for getting called for dinner or whatever. I think he said at one point, he's like, I didn't know what we were volunteering for.
Yeah, so they had that kind of really raw conversation on, people had to do a lot of crap that they really did not want to do. So, I mean, Schofield could have easily hated Blake for it. He did a little bit, he showed it, but I mean, ultimately, like, he got over it, so.
Yeah, and then not only that, he had to like be there when he died, and then when he finally got to deliver his message, like he found Blake's brother and had to explain to him that his brother died.
Yeah.
Yeah, so he had to go through all that only to tell like this guy his brother died.
Yeah. Well, now here's kind of the one of the pinnacle elements of this that I caught the first time I watched it, but didn't really resonate as much as it did this time. And that was that when he finally got done and he delivered his message, like you think about that impact that he and Blake had, where essentially, what they did saved thousands of lives, but then nobody gave a crap. Like
No.
there was no recognition. Cumberbatch treated him like a complete jerk. He only got one thank you, and then everybody else who was around him, like nobody knew what he just did.
Oh yeah,
Like,
Cumberbatch, like as the colonel,
one other guy, yeah.
yeah, like he reads the message and then he tells him to fuck off,
Yeah.
which
Like,
caught me
all right.
off guard. I'm like, okay.
Yeah. Well, if he hadn't gotten that warning from that one guy he got a ride from, it may have not happened at all. So that was kind of interesting. But yeah, no, I dwelt on it a little bit more this time, just the idea of like, you watch the story and you're just like, man, that's amazing. That's a real war hero. We should remember somebody like that. And then you're thinking, all the people that he just saved, like none of them know that. None of them know that they even need to be grateful to him. Like it's just another day, and
Right.
like nobody kind of cares about him.
Yeah, they're like, who's this dude that doesn't have any weapons and he's running out onto the battlefield?
Yeah.
That scene was kind of crazy too, and like bombs
Yeah, it's
going off
fucking
everywhere.
wild. Yeah, I can hit with.
Yeah, I remember
Now, the
watching.
ending I thought was a little anticlimactic. I wasn't sure how they could really end this, but like he finds Blake's brother, tells him that like he died, and he asks for like if he could write to their mom and like explain that, he didn't die alone and everything, and that he's a good guy. But then he just walks off and he sits under a tree and he looks at photos and that's the end.
Yeah, well, I actually liked the ending, because it made the perfect circle. Because basically, I mean, that's exactly how the movie started. Because he was resting up against a tree in a field.
That's true.
And so I saw the
Yeah.
full circle kind of like coming to an end. Was it anticlimactic? Yeah, totally, absolutely. I see that. But I mean, like, really, the climax was when he delivered the message and how that all broke down. And so they kind of just had him find his brother and kind of just wrapped up the details and then needed some way to finish it. And I thought, considering the weight of everything else that happened, that it was a good decision on finishing the movie that way.
Yeah, I think that's a fair assessment for sure. I like how it ended. Yeah, like especially after going through everything that he did, it kind of just ended like, this somber kind of moment, of reflection or whatever underneath the tree. It was kind of nice.
It's kind of one of those things where, like, I mean, kind of going back to what we were talking about before, like, you really kind of hope and root for him being like, yeah, like, tell everybody what this guy did. Let him get a moment of praise. And, like, dude, even just give him, like, a decent meal or something. But it was just kind of like, you did your job. That's it. Like, no
No
special,
attaboy.
yeah, no special
Right.
treatment. On
I
to
think
the
he
next
did. Okay,
thing.
to be fair, he got the one attaboy from like right after Cumberbatch told him to fuck off. Like that guy
Yeah.
that was like right there is like,
He's like, yeah,
he's
you
like,
did a good job.
thanks for saving all of our asses, today at
Thanks.
least. Today at least, right? So,
Yeah.
dude, that trench warfare was something insane. And just, it's absolutely chaotic.
Yeah,
It
but quite
was.
a bit different from, because, like, watching Saving Private Ryan, which was World War II, and watching this, which was World War I. Yeah, quite a few
Oh my
different
God,
things.
I'm surprised it didn't show any like, I mean they obviously showed some of the Germans, but I'm surprised it didn't do any like mustard gas or, show anything else really to show some of the horrors. So I feel like this kind of happened in, like obviously everyone going over the trenches at like the end, right? And then just running into the fight across the land, but like even that didn't really show a lot.
Yeah, not
Like
like
it
Saving
didn't
Private
really
Ryan that
focus
showed
on like the
limbs flying.
horrors. Yeah, like
Yeah.
obviously they showed like the dead bodies in the rivers and like that kind of stuff and like the decimated areas, but like I don't know, it some of the atrocities that were in World War One are definitely not were kind of left out. I feel like not that they should be in there, but I
Yeah,
felt
it
like there
was.
was a lot that was kind of missing too that they could have added.
Yeah. Yeah, it was. I mean, like, it's a really unique kind of circumstance because it's not your typical war movie. Because the goal for them was to not really fight if they could.
Right, to stop them, yeah.
Yeah, so it all in all, it was like pretty unique in every unique in different ways. So, I mean,
It
you
was kind of
got.
nice to see like the tactics too, like the German tactics of like even retreating to kind of like bait them into coming. Again, putting all the like the trip wires and that kind of stuff.
Yeah, I was just gonna mention that. Like, you gotta see some interesting stuff with like the booby traps, and then they left a sniper there on the bridge that tried taking him out, and just the different ways they had it set up. Because yeah, man, there were not a lot of Germans. I mean, heck, I think
No.
what like there was maybe like
Small
half a
handful.
dozen,
Yeah.
maybe 10.
Well, they
So,
showed too, like the, this has definitely happened, but like a lot of the, when they retreat like that, like they decimate those areas. Like they want nothing left behind. Like even I think when they were in the car or the truck, like they shot like those, they killed those cows because they were worried like, oh, they'd have something to eat or whatever, so they just kill them just because,
Well, even then, the chopping down the cherry trees, which I'm just like, dude, do you know how much time and effort that would take?
yeah, but
Like,
it's
come on.
resources they don't get, so
Yeah.
never know.
So we've talked about this before with, lots of other movies about runtime. And kind of funny story about that. Caleb and I were talking the other day. I just said, like, because I've been so busy and stuff with work that I haven't had as much time to like really sit down and watch movies and everything. So I have to like try to squeeze them in when I can. And I told him, because I watched this on Plex, and I'm like, I wish that Plex had like a 1.5 times speed so I could speed along watching these 3 hour war movies. And Caleb made the point, like, well, you might be missing something, and like it takes away of like the viewing effect and everything. And
Sure.
I said, yeah, that's true. And he's like, plus this movie's only 2 hours long.
Yeah. Saving Private was a 3 hour one. I thought this one was
Yeah.
longer than 2 hours,
I
but
didn't think so. You know what you're probably thinking of is All Quiet on the Western Front. That one's pretty long.
yeah.
If you guys haven't done that one yet already.
No.
Yeah, no, I haven't seen it.
We covered a good variety of wars this month, and it wasn't even planned.
Oh. Yeah, this one's 2.5. So I
Because
mean
we
it
did.
feels like it's longer, but it's only 2.5 hours.
Because we got this one, which is World War I. And then Saving Private Ryan is World War II. And then Full Metal Jacket is Vietnam. And we also have Platoon, but I can't remember.
That's Vietnam.
That's a Vietnam one too, as
Yeah.
well. Yeah.
Yep.
I feel like there's not very many World War I movies. I feel like they're all World War II or Vietnam.
Yeah, I mean, no, and that's like All Quiet on the Western Front is one, but it's, yeah, there's not very many.
Yeah, I can't think of.
Not of like big box office stuff, right?
Yeah. Got some older ones. Yeah, quite a few older ones.
Yeah, you're gonna get a lot of those, right?
Well, then you got Rambo 3, which is in Afghanistan. Desert Storm. But, and we already covered that one a while back. Anything else to talk about, or you want me to get into the trivia and facts?
One thing that I just want to point out before we move to trivia and facts, that I kind of like took note this time of watching it, talking about that woman that he ran into, I don't know if you caught all the dialogue, but that was not her baby. That was like she didn't know whose baby it was. She just like
Okay.
found it.
Just found it.
Yeah, and so I was just thinking like how insane that would be to grow up and have that be your story where it's just like you don't know who your mom is, you don't know who your dad is, and you were just like found during the war. Like I can't even like process that really on like what that would be like with not even really knowing who you are.
Well, I mean, and
Yeah.
they never even circle back, obviously, in the movie either, so you have no idea if they were found or not, or
Yeah. So, but I mean, like, there's got to be so many stories like that.
Oh,
So
yeah.
just some of those things that you don't get talked to a lot about during war movies, but that was kind of like an interesting thing that popped in my head. So.
All right, so trivia and facts. Sir Sam Mendes, who was the director, and Lee Smith, who was the editor, stated that despite the apparently continuous shot broken only by one interval of unconsciousness, like we talked about, actually dozens of invisible edits were made, concealed by transitions through black, moving behind objects, and so on. According to Mendes, the shortest unbroken shot was 39 seconds long, while the longest continuous shot was 8.5 minutes long,
Wow, really? Only
which is
8.5 minutes.
crazy.
Minutes.
Well,
Wow.
if you think about it, like watch any other movie, and I'd be shocked if there was a scene that was 8.5 minutes long that wasn't
Right.
cut.
Yeah.
Well, did you see
No.
how many do you find out how many like total cuts there are? Or...
No. They didn't have that on there.
Oh, I think I found it. It was like 32 total.
Dang.
Yeah, that's
That's
crazy. I'm
crazy.
sure it's like stupid low, right? But
Yeah.
Yeah. 39 seconds. That's like, I don't even know where they, it must have been maybe in one of the fighting scenes or something, because I was trying really hard to kind of pay attention on being like, oh, they probably cut right there, they probably cut here.
Yeah, they
But
kind of like go on the other side of it, like as they move across a pillar or something, like that's when they cut it or something, you know?
yeah, I think a lot of the times when they would spin, so like they're facing one direction and then the camera spins and like wouldn't look at the characters, but actually just kind of like turn, especially like in the trenches, it would turn from one direction to another. That's a really easy kind of spot to switch as well. So,
Yeah, you must
yeah.
feel like you're a third person in that. Like, you know, you're just kind of there with them on their journey the whole time. So
Yeah.
it's especially because you're always at that kind of like eye level view pretty much the entire
Where the
time.
camera's like a character.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it took 6 months for the actors to rehearse the movie before shooting started.
Wow.
Yeah. This movie was inspired by the director's grandfather's experience in World War One. It was a memoir that was the autobiography of Alfred H. Mendez from 1897 to 1991.
Okay.
Is he living that long?
Yeah. So over 5,200 feet of trenches were dug for the film.
Man.
Yeah.
You would think that there would be some places that would just leave some of this stuff set up. You know,
Yeah.
like there's gonna be more World War One movies. There's gonna be more, you know, World War Two movies. You would think, depending on where they set it up, where it's just like, hey, we're gonna set this up, we're gonna charge you a rate to come and use it, and then like, you know, help contribute to our cost for building it. Because yeah, it's crazy how much money gets put into making some of these things, and then they just like get rid of it afterwards.
Yeah, they just fill it in. Yeah.
Just be like the premier place to film a World War One, World War Two movie.
Yeah.
It's kind of like the
Maybe.
there's this cave. For the life of me, I can't think of the name of it. It's in the desert in California, and like millions of things have been shot there.
Oh, yeah.
Like
Oh,
it was the establishing shot for like the Batcave for the Adam West Batman show.
yeah. Nice.
But just yeah, millions of other things have been shot there.
Surprised they didn't actually shoot this in like not necessarily in Germany, but what like France and some of the actual like no man's land area.
Yeah.
They shot it in like England, I think.
So the director says his grandfather Alfred, who I mentioned earlier, he entered World War One as 17 in 1916, carried messages through no man's land. He was only 5 foot 4 and was often hidden by the winter mist that reached as high as 6 feet. Two years in the muddy trenches left Alfred with a lifelong habit of washing his hands frequently. And he didn't talk about his wartime experiences until he was in his 70s.
Dude, I was just thinking, you know, if you had a short enough person, like, could they dress as a woman and just kind of like go through the countryside and maybe not be bothered so
Yeah,
much?
or a kid or something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm sure the Germans probably were watching everybody and anything that was moving in the area, I guess. So,
Yeah, say it wasn't Vietnam where they were shooting almost everybody.
yeah.
Yeah. So one of the biggest headaches for the film crew was a cigarette lighter that wouldn't work on cue for one scene. It was leading to several retakes and wasting most of the day's filming.
A cigarette lighter?
Yeah, a cigarette lighter. So the soldiers drink alcohol in many scenes during World War One, battle rations included. 2.5 fluid ounces of alcohol. Soldiers behind the lines got it twice a week. Those who were on the front lines got it daily, with double rations when they went over the top, like Stallone in 87. German trenches were in much better condition than the British trenches. The Germans anticipated the war would last a long time, and they tried to make their trenches comfortable as possible. with underground bunkers and even having electricity in some parts.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
They kind of showed that in the movie.
In an interview, Christy Wilson Carnes said that George MacKay never left the day of shooting without shaking everybody's hands. He knew everyone's name. He had time for everyone on set, all the assistants, all the runners. He knew everyone's names. He spent a lot of time learning about them and learning about their lives.
Nice.
It almost sounds like a Bill Murray story. Like you hear about Bill Murray like bringing donuts for like crew members and stuff and shooting.
Yeah.
Yeah. So Lieutenant Leslie tells the soldiers, or soldiers, I'm sorry, to avoid the craters. They are deeper than you think. The warning was to avoid stepping to the bottom of a crater that was filled with water. The mud under the water would be so thick that a soldier would get stuck and eventually die from exhaustion, exposure, or gunfire. Yeah. So basically kind of quicksand.
Yeah.
This was the last film to win the Academy Award for Best Sound Mixing before the award was combined with Best Sound Editing.
Okay.
And the last thing I got is this movie cost $95 million and it made 390 in the box office.
390.
Yeah.
That's a pretty good
Yeah, nice
turn.
success. Yeah.
Yeah. So grades. I pulled from IMDb and Rotten Tomatoes. What do you think they are?
I think I saw IMDb. So Jason, I don't know if you have a guess or if you saw it as well.
No, I didn't see it. I don't know, I give it probably an 8.7.
It's an 8.2.
Okay,
Okay.
yeah, that's what I thought. I did wind up seeing that.
Then Rotten
Makes
Tomatoes.
sense.
These I definitely don't know. So for a Rotten Tomato critic score, I don't know, I'd probably guess like a 92%.
88.
Okay.
Okay.
Rotten Tomato
Makes sense.
critic Jason, do you want to take a shot at the critic, or I
Or
mean
the
not critic,
audience
the
one.
audience, the audience.
The audience. Probably go with what is it? Is it out of 10? I'm trying to
It's
remember
out
the
of
percentage.
100%.
100%.
Hundred, yeah.
Yeah, probably like a 78.
It's an 88.
Okay.
88
88
They're
and
both
88.
88. Yeah, I can't
Oh,
remember the
they're both
last
the
time that
same.
happened.
All right.
Yeah. So, who wants to go first with her career?
Jason, you're the guest. Do us the
Ah,
honors.
fine. No. What are we doing? What are we doing?
Out of five.
Out of five?
Yeah.
Yep.
I probably give it like a 4.5. It's th there's a lot of great things. Like I wish there was a little bit more. It does get a little feel a little drawn out, but I think that's kind of the point, you know. But overall, it's super powerful and shows you the tragedies of war for sure.
Yeah, that's actually what I fell on too. It's a 4.5.
Right.
It does feel longer at times. Like I said, I thought it was 3 hours and it was two.
Right, yeah.
That was more of me thinking I saw 2 hours and 58 minutes or something like that on IMDb when it's really an hour and 58 minutes, something like that. Yeah, it does have like a little bit of a lag at times, but it does build character really well and it's shot so great. And there are some really tense scenes, like we talked about, the burning church and all that kind of stuff, and when he floats down the river and things like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was definitely a pretty good movie. I enjoyed it.
Rock. Yeah, well, I'm gonna change things up a little bit. I actually have it as a 5 out of 5.
Okay.
So kind of usually giving a little bit of a description each time. I basically kind of rate the movie for in comparison to the genre in general. So as far as war movies go, this is definitely one of the more unique ones. I mean, the whole continuous shot concept. And even though it is really hyper focused on a very unique situation, it really helps you kind of like get engrossed into that unique situation because, as you know, it was kind of said in praise, like it's a third person shot. It's kind of like you're there with them in the experience. So definitely kind of understand how sometimes it gets a little bit slow, but it really was that experience of like, this is practically what they would have exactly gone through. Like maybe the time was a little bit sped up, but I mean, step for step, that's like kind of the experience. So I thought that was really cool and unique. And so I like kind of a general reaction to it. I think I could easily give it, or I can easily say like it'd be a top 10 war movie for me. I'd probably put it in top five. I'd probably have to break it down a little bit, but just the uniqueness of it kind of sets it apart for me and gives it a little extra bump. Because yeah, then really, if I were to turn the perspective into okay, what's wrong with it or what could be improved, it's kind of tough for me to say much of anything other than like maybe a little bit of time could have been shaved off. And there were a few things that drug out maybe a little bit, but like I said, I think that was purposely done and kind of worked more towards the benefit than anything else.
I think
So
it only took over the what it was supposed to be over what, like 2 days?
it was supposed to be like, I think they said it was going to be like a 8 to 10 hour stretch of time possibly, because they left before dark and then he got knocked out, and so we don't know exactly how long he was knocked out for. So it was kind of like from maybe like, I don't know, just a rough time frame, maybe from like 6 o'clock at night to like 8 o'clock in the morning or something. So, yeah, so
Yeah, but
depending on how he's knocked out.
yeah, I mean, because he meets up with that girl a little bit later, right? And then that's when it was like the sun's coming up here soon, so that's him like kind of venturing out. Yeah, getting across that land.
Yeah, and then by the time he reaches the colonel that he's got to talk to, it's daylight.
Yeah, 'cause he right before he got knocked out, it was still a little daylight. And then he got knocked out, and then he woke up and it was pitch black out. And so who knows exactly what time it was. Like it could have been like midnight, it could have been like 5 in the morning, or
Right, you think about it too, is like, yeah, he went on no sleep. Like really, besides obviously being knocked out for whatever long, you know, that time, like he didn't sleep that entire time. So he was just going, going, going. You know, and being shot at and everything else on top of that. So it's pretty wild.
Yeah, he probably had enough adrenaline to make
Yeah,
him
no
go out.
kidding. Like
Yeah,
it's,
I couldn't imagine.
oh man. But
Yeah, so solid grades all around. Yeah, next time we're going to be watching Full Metal Jacket, which is a movie I've seen quite a few times. And I don't know what it is. Vietnam movies always seem to like hit for me. The whole thing's just interesting. I mean, really,
No,
it's like
yeah.
the only war that the US lost. So there's
Yeah.
that intrigue in that.
Pretty much, right? So.
And I don't know, it's got some comedic elements in it as well. So be interested to talk about that one. If you guys are liking the show, please subscribe and share. Follow us on social media. We're on pretty much every platform. We got a fair amount of stuff on YouTube and TikTok lately, so check those out. If you like Vietnam movies, come by next week. We're going to be talking about Full Metal Jacket. But until then, as always, be kind and rewind.